coming on the clouds. Kings and kingdoms will bow down. And every chain will break as broken hearts declare his praise. Who can stop the Lord Almighty? Our God is the Lion of Judah. He's roaring with power and fighting our battles. And every knee will bow before him. Our God is the Lamb that was slain for the sin of the world. His blood breaks the chains. And every knee will bow before the Lion and the Lamb. Bow before the Lion and the Lamb. So open up the gates, make way before the King of Kings. The God who comes to save is here to set the captives free. For who can stop the Lord Almighty? Our God is the Lion of Judah. He's roaring with power and fighting our battles. And every knee will bow before him. Our God is the sin of the world. His blood breaks the chains, and every knee will bow before the Lion and the Lamb. Oh, every knee will bow before the Lion and the Lamb. Who can stop the Lord Almighty? 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 Who can stop the Lord? Our God is the Lion of Judah. He's roaring with power and fighting our battles. Every knee will bow before him. Our God is the sin of the world. His blood breaks the chains, and every knee will bow before the Lion and the Lamb. Oh, every knee will bow before the Lion and the Lamb. Oh, every knee will bow before the Lion and the Lion and the Lamb.
Amen. Is that over? Okay, just making sure. Good morning, everybody. How's everybody doing? Well, welcome to Calvary Baptist. I'm glad you're all here. I'm going to have a word of prayer in a minute, and then we'll greet one another, but just want to welcome you to the service. As you can see, Pete's got this big old tank next to him, and it's our baptismal tank.
Amen.
So we're going to have a baptism today. Young Serena Donadio is going to make a profession of faith. She already knows the Lord, but she's going to declare that before the church this morning.
Amen.
And get baptized as a testimony of her faith in the Lord Jesus Christ. So we commend her for that. Praise the Lord. And you're here this morning and you're saying, man, I'm jealous. I should do that. I need to take that step of faith. Well, can't do it today. I need to talk to you first, make sure you understand what it means, but it's not that hard to slide it back out. Next Sunday, even on Easter morning, I will baptize you if you want to be baptized, all right? So we praise the Lord for the wonderful day we have before us. And then after the regular service, we're going to have a time downstairs called Develop Calvary. We have two really important things going on in this church. Discover Calvary is for those who want to become members. They have to go to a class called Discover Calvary where they come to understand what the church is all about. And then we have Develop Calvary, where that's where we want to share the vision and really encourage those who are already serving and be a blessing to you for helping build this church. And we're going to feed you today as a way to say thank you. And all are welcome to come, whether you're serving or not. Please stick around, come downstairs, and then we're going to share the vision of the church and just go through where we're heading. What's the goal of this church, and how can we all get there together as a body of Christ? Sound good?
Amen.
All right. Well, let me have a word of prayer, and then we will greet one another. Some of you can greet one another with a holy kiss. Others just shake hands, whatever you feel comfortable doing. All right? Well, let's pray. We give you thanks and praise, Lord Jesus, for your goodness to us. Thank you that we could be gathered here this morning. Pray your blessing upon each one, that you will have your way in our hearts, and that we will be challenged but also encouraged because we are your people and you have great, great things in store for us as we walk with you. And we pray your blessing upon this service, blessing upon those who might be watching on YouTube, and may they be blessed by you. And also, God, I just pray you continue to build this church is your church, and continue to build, and we pray your blessing upon us, even this morning as we gather. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Amen.
Please turn around and greet somebody. Morning.
Hi there. Feel it. Feel it. Nice and warm, huh? It's nice, huh? Gonna take a bath later.
Put down the child and duck her shower.
Yes.
Put the child down.
Here we go.
Listen to Katie. Watch the sign on her hand. Watch these kids.
They have the signs and colors.
All of creation, all of the earth, make straight a highway, a path for the Lord. Jesus is coming soon. Call back the sinner, wake up the saint, let every nation shout of your name. Jesus is coming soon. Like a bride waiting for her groom, we'll be a church ready for you. Every heart longing for our King, we sing, even so come, Lord Jesus. Lord Jesus, come. There will be justice, all will be new. Your name forever, faithful and true. Jesus is coming soon. Like a bride.
Next song is All I Have is Christ. And I've heard it said that the richest man is the man who needs the least. But it's an interesting paradox. You think about the title of the song, All I Have is Christ. It might sound like you don't have much. But if all of you have is Christ, you have everything. Amen. You then are the richest people on this planet, because one day you're going to be with him outside this planet. Isn't that great? Amen. Let's sing this song. Sing out. Open your mouth. Praise and worship to God right now, because all I have is Christ.
I once was lost in darkest night, yet thought I knew the way, the sin that brought
Hallelujah. Amen. Please be seated.
Where do I put this?
It's good to go. Right here.
Amen. Whoa. Woke a couple of you up? No? I'll leave that there. I invite you to turn in your Bibles to 1 Corinthians chapter 3, looking at verses 5 through 17. 1 Corinthians 3, verses 5 through 17. This is the second time we're looking at these verses on principles of serving the Lord Jesus Christ. Principles of serving. All we have is Christ, the Lord Jesus. And, you know, as we ended last week's message, just thinking about our reward as believers, we will be rewarded by Jesus. And physically, there'll be rewards for those who have been serving the Lord. But I tell you, I don't know about you, but the reward I am looking forward to is just the smile on Jesus' face, seeing Jesus face to face with a smile, saying to me, "Well done, thou good and faithful servant. You endured, you did it, and you served me well." And I want to hear those words from Jesus. I want to see his face smiling and pleased with the labor of love that I have in this time on earth, we're all given different amount of time, our lifespan on earth as believers in the Lord Jesus Christ. No one knows how long they have. But may we all come to a place in our life where the motivation, passion, the drive of our hearts and life are that we want to be well-pleasing to the Lord Jesus Christ. And so all the songs that we sang are just reminding us, brothers and sisters, Jesus is coming. Jesus is coming. Don't dig so deep into this world and think this is all you got. Don't think so gloomy thoughts and say, oh man, look at all the hopelessness around us. Jesus is coming back. Don't lose heart. Don't grow weary in doing good. Jesus is going to come back. Jesus said, I am coming quickly. Maybe not quick enough for some of us, right? He's on a different time than you and I are on. He says, I am coming quickly, and my reward is with me to give to everyone according to his work. Paul believed that, and Paul made it his aim in life to be well-pleasing to the Lord. For he knew that we all must appear before the judgment seat of Christ, that each one may receive the things done in the body, whether good or worthless. And then as we look at verse 13 of our text, Paul says, each one's work will become clear, for the day will declare it, because it will be revealed by fire, and the fire will test each one's work of what sort it is. Nothing is going to be hidden from that day. Chapter 4, verse 5 says, therefore judge nothing before the time until the Lord comes, who will both bring to light the hidden things of darkness and reveal the counsels of the heart, the motivation of why we are doing what we're doing. And then he says, each one's praise will come from God. All of our works will be declared on that day. It will be revealed by fire, for the fire will test each one's work. Now, these are sobering words that I begin this message with, and I do it for a reason. I don't like to joke around that much behind the pulpit, because we're dealing with sacred words. We don't have a lot of time left. When God judges me as the pastor of Calvary Baptist, and my life as a husband and a father and as a pastor, he's not going to judge me for how good of a joke I told, right? He's not going to judge me by how many times I made you laugh. I hope that I do make you laugh a couple times here and there, but that's not my goal in life, because these are sobering words and sobering times and words that we need to take to heart and do what we can to be prepared for that day. And so, with all that said, I'd like to read verses 5 through 17 again and pray and ask the Holy Spirit to use these words in our lives. So, chapter 3, verse 5 through 17, this is the passage that we are learning as we go through this whole book of 1 Corinthians. We find ourselves in chapter 3 now. Look at verse 5, would you? Who then is Paul, and who is Apollos, but ministers, servants through whom you believed, and as the Lord gave to each one, I planted, Apollos watered, but God gave the increase. Now he who plants and he who waters are one, and each one will receive his own reward according to his own labor. For we are God's fellow workers. You are God's field. You are God's building. According to the grace of God, which was given to me as a wise master builder, I have laid the foundation and another builds on it. But let each one take heed how he builds on it. For no other foundation can one lay than that which is Jesus Christ. Now, if anyone builds on this foundation with gold, silver, and precious stones, wood, hay, and straw, each one's work will become clear, for the day will declare it, because it will be revealed by fire, and the fire will test each one's work of what sort it is. If anyone's work which he has built on it endures, he or she will receive a reward. If anyone's work is burnt, he will suffer loss, but he himself will be saved, yet so as through fire. Do you not know that you are the temple of God and that the Spirit of God dwells in you? If anyone defiles or destroys the temple of God, God will destroy him, for the temple of God is holy, which temple you are. Father, as we take time to understand these precious words, sacred words of the Scriptures, as we're gathered here this morning to worship you in the hearing of the Word of God, Lord, I pray that you will bring these words alive, and may they not just be words on a piece of paper, but may they come alive, as your Word says that your Word is living and active and powerful, and it's like a sword, cuts us to the heart and divides the soul and the spirit. And Lord, may that word, the word spoken today, this morning, be powerful, not because I am speaking, but because you are powerful and your words are powerful. And so, Lord, I'm at your mercy. We are all at your mercy. We pray that you will have your way in all of our hearts, that we would hear well, that you'll give us ears to hear, eyes to see, and a heart to understand the truth, that this time spent in hearing the Word of God will be profitable for each person, and that we would leave here changed and obedient servants of the Lord, willing to do all that you ask us to do. And so have your way and have mercy on us all. In Jesus' precious name, I pray. Amen. Now, we covered the first 5 points that I mentioned last week, so my message today is mainly going to be on one of those points, and there are things that we can learn in this text. So before I get into that last point that I want to share with you this morning, I believe if you're like me, you forgot what I said last week, right? So just a quick reminder of what this text is teaching. That's why I read verses 5 through 17. We're only going to cover verses 10 through 17 this morning. But number one, these principles of serving, number one, all of us need to understand that each believer is a servant. And I see that in verse 5 where Paul is correcting the Corinthian thinking by saying, who then is Paul? Or what is Paul and what is Apollos? And what he answers the question by saying, but we're just ministers. And that word ministers is the same Greek word for deacons. And it's the same Greek word that just simply means this. Doulos. We're servants for the Lord. That's all we are. Nothing more, nothing less. Every believer is a servant. And this begins with an attitude. All of us need to have that kind of attitude, because if you don't have that kind of attitude, it's never going to lead to any kind of action. If you don't have the attitude that you are a servant, you'll never have the action that follows it, that I am a servant, I am here to serve. I want you to understand there's not two classes of Christians. There's not one level of Christian that's more spiritual than the other. Every Christian, every believer, every follower of Christ, God wants you to understand you're not supposed to be on the sidelines, just observing and being a spectator. No, every believer is a servant, and it begins with an attitude that I am a servant of the Lord. I am going to be judged by the Lord as a steward. What did I do with the resources that he's given to me? What have I done with the things that he's given me to do in my life? Do I see myself as a servant? Secondly, each servant can be a vessel used by God. He says, who then is Paul? Who is Apollos? But ministers through whom you believed. Isn't that a wonderful thought? That your life is being watched by other people, and the things that you do in life can contribute to being used by God as a vessel to bless somebody. Paul says, I planted, Apollos watered, and that's things that we do in our life that make us being used by God, that you can be a mouth for God, you could be hands for God, feet for God, being used by God as a vessel, everyone. Just think of that. Somebody can believe in the Lord Jesus Christ through the way you serve the Lord. Thirdly, each believer has been given a task by God. He says, who are we? Who is Paul? Who is Apollos? But ministers to whom you believe, as the Lord gave to each one. That literally is saying, as the Lord has assigned each one. So think about that. Your life and my life as a Christian has purpose, has meaning. You're not to be living your life aimlessly. When you were not a believer, you lived your life aimlessly to some extent. But now that you are a believer in the Lord Jesus Christ, what is your aim? Your aim is to be well-pleasing to him, right? That's what Paul said. I make it my aim to be well-pleasing to him. And so God has gifted every believer with a spiritual gift. And he's given you talents to serve the Lord. You're using those talents probably every day and you're getting paid for it. Is that not right? Some of you are good with numbers. Some of you are good at thinking at work. And I hope you're all thinking at work, right? See, I made you laugh. Look at that. That wasn't funny. No. But all of us at our workplace, you guys are getting paid. Some of you guys are getting paid. You get good money because you're pretty good at what you're doing. And that's a talent. But listen, you might have went to school, right? Maybe you learn how to do that, whatever you're doing. But don't forget about God. What you're doing is a gift from God. God has given you that work. God has given you the ability. He's given you a talent. And now when you add spiritual gifts to that, God has given you a spiritual gift. They're different than talents, and that's a whole different sermon, right? But you have spiritual gift. You have talents. So everyone has a specific gift, a specific talent, a task that they should be doing in the church of the Lord Jesus. And so what I'm trying to plead with you is for you to see that sometimes the things you're even doing at work and what you're good at can be used right here in the church. If you're good at organizing things and you're good at vision and you're good at certain things, why don't you just say, hey, you know what? And that's what Develop Calvary is going to be all about later on today. You're going to be exposed to some things that might be helpful, that you can see, hey, I'm good at that. I can help you guys. Come on. Come on. We're all building here, all right? And so we're all given a task by the Lord. Each believer, number four, as a servant, is equally important. And so God, people who clean the bathrooms are important. People who keep this building clean are important. Preachers and deacons and whatever Sunday school teachers, we're all important. No one is more important than the other. And so we all need to see that each of our tasks is important, because he says there in verse 8, now he who plants and he who waters are one. One is not better than the other. And that's what the Corinthians were doing. Some were saying, oh, no, Paul's better. No. Apollos is better. I like the way that guy talks. No. And we do that in the church today. Some are like I have a problem. I like Scottish accents. And so I listen to Alistair Begg, right? Or the other Scottish guy, I forgot his name for a second there. But hey, I like listening to certain preachers preach because I like their accent. My accent's all messed up because I don't think anyone likes my accents. But it's all mixed up between New York and Boston. And I don't know what I sound like to you guys. But anyway, doesn't take too long for me to start talking and someone say, ha, 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 you're not from around here, are you? Yeah, okay. So each one is important. I don't know where I was going with that one. Number five, each believer will be rewarded. Look at verse 8. Now he who plants and he who waters are one, and each one will receive his own reward according to his own labor. Verse 14, if anyone's work which he has built on endures, what? He will receive a reward. Be motivated to know that you're going to be rewarded for all of the work you do here for the Lord Jesus Christ. And that brings us to this sixth point that I want to spend the rest of our time on. Each believer's work. What you do matters to Jesus. How you do what you do matters to Jesus, because you're going, that work that you do is going to be tested by God. So Paul says here in verses 10 and 11 that those who serve the Lord are building on a foundation. According to the grace of God, which was given to me as a wise master builder, I have laid the foundation and another builds on it. But let each one take heed how he builds on it, for no other foundation can anyone lay than that which is laid, which is Jesus Christ. And so Paul says that he's laid a foundation. And then you and I and Apollos and all the other servants after all the other apostles are building on that foundation. So the question I ask is, what is the foundation that we are building on? What is this foundation? Well, this foundation is the rock of all ages. This foundation is Christianity. This foundation is secure. Nothing can destroy this foundation. People will try to destroy the foundation, but Christianity cannot be destroyed. It is the rock of all ages. No other foundation can be laid. And so this ought to bring comfort to your heart to know that the foundation has been laid already. It is secure, which means that if you are building your church or you're building your life on that foundation, what? It's secure. Aren't you glad that part's taken care of? Aren't you glad that that is taken care of, that you don't have to worry about building the foundation? The foundation is the most important part of any building, and that has already been laid for you and I, and it is Christ and his teaching. Now, in saying that, some make the foolish choice of rejecting this foundation and attempt to build their life or to build the church their own way. In Matthew chapter 7, verses 24 to 27, Jesus gives us a little analogy here of the people who build wisely and people who build foolishly. In verse 24, he says, "Therefore, whoever hears these sayings of mine and does them, I will liken him to a wise man who built his house on the rock. And the rain descended and the floods came and the winds blew and beat on that house, and it did not fall, for it was founded on the rock. But everyone who hears these sayings of mine and does not do them will be like a foolish person who built his house on the sand, and the rain descended and the floods came and the winds blew and beat on that house, and it fell, and great was its fall." And so some people reject the foundation that has been laid and try to say, "Well, you know, I'm clever, I'm wise. The Corinthians were buying into the Greek philosophy and human wisdom and building their own way." And people do that today. They attempt to build their life their own way. And the scriptures say that it's foolish. It's foolish for you to build your life your own way. Your life will come crashing down because you're making unwise choices. The Corinthians were fascinated with the philosophies of their day. And when judgment comes, what they built will not stand. Many people are building on a foundation that is like sand. Man's opinions and man's ideas. And when tough times come, everything is going to fall apart. Everything is going to fall apart. And so in verse 10, Paul points out that he laid the foundation, which is Christ and his teaching. Others have come along and built on it. Obviously, he's talking about Apollos and Peter. He's also talking about you and me. So all those who are believers are also builders. Last week, we learned that we are planters and some are waterers. But now, he's saying that every Christian, every believer is a builder. You're a construction worker. You are building on the foundation. You're building your life. You're building the church. You're building your life as you follow the teachings of Christ and you're living out these truths and doing what you are doing by building on that foundation. God is also building as well. God takes your life and my life. As I commit my ways to the Lord, He is building my life, and He's building this wonderful thing called the church. It's a wonderful, wonderful truth to know that Christ is building my life. There's another passage that makes this clear to us in 1 Peter chapter 2, verses 4 and 5. Listen to this. Coming to Him, coming to Jesus, as to a living stone, rejected indeed by men, but chosen by God and precious. You also, as living stones, are being built up a spiritual house, a holy priesthood, to offer up spiritual sacrifices acceptable to God through Jesus Christ. And so listen to me. If you find your life right now, you're not in the place where you ought to be as a believer, could it be that you are not building your life on the rock of ages? Could it be that you're not building your life on that foundation, but perhaps you are like the person who built his life on the sand, the shifting sands of man's ideas and opinions. And you're not where you ought to be right now because you are not building your life God's way. And listen, I want to warn you, this is not a good place to be. It is actually a dangerous, dangerous place to be spiritually. Life is going to fall apart for you if you are not building your life on the foundation of Christ and His teaching. When trouble times come, and they will, everything is going to fall apart. And so Paul says here in verse 10 that she who builds must take heed how they build. In other words, there is a right way and there is a wrong way to build your life, and there is a right way and a wrong way to build the church. And those who build, those who serve the Lord, are going to be praised by the Lord. In the end, some will receive greater praise, some will receive lesser praise, but all will be praised before the Lord. Wouldn't it be a wonderful thing to know that you're building your life the way the Lord wants to? We're not always going to do it the way He wants to, but we are pursuing the way the Lord wants us to build our life and the way He wants us to build this church. Paul says in verse 11, there's only one foundation that we can build off of, only one that God will accept, Jesus Christ and Him crucified. Jesus said that He was the way, the truth, and the life, that no one can come to God the Father unless they come through Jesus, the way of the cross, the message that Paul preached, and the only message that the church should preach is that Jesus Christ is the only way. That is the foundation. What are you building your life on, brother and sister? My friend, as you are here this morning, what are you building your life on? Now, it is important to hear this because in the remaining verses, Paul is going to lay out for us how we ought to be building our life. What kind of material are we to use? What kind of material is good? And what kind of material is worthless in God's eyes? So again, every believer is a servant. Every believer is a builder. You are a construction worker. Both men and ladies, you are too. All right? But he's going to mention here in verse 12 the kind of material that we ought to be using on this foundation that has been laid for us. Listen to the word of the Lord. He says, now if anyone builds on this foundation with gold, silver, and precious stones, wood, hay, and straw, each one's work will become clear for the day will reveal it. And so, he's mentioning these different types of material that we use in building on this foundation. These materials that he has mentioned are all spiritual metaphors for the quality of work that you do. Doesn't matter what you're doing, to some extent. What matters is the quality of work, how you are building. He says, take heed how you are building. And so he lays out different material that we ought to use. Obviously, these are spiritual metaphors. These are not literal things that we are using in our life, because none of us are walking around with gold, silver, well, maybe on a ring or something like that, but it's just spiritual metaphors for how we ought to be building. These materials, gold, silver, and precious stones, are
being spiritually stored up for us in heaven by God. Jesus said it. Store up for yourself treasures in heaven. They're not going to rot. They're not going to fade away. And these are the things he's talking about. The works that we do for Jesus matter. The quality of our service are going to be tested by the Lord. There's some material that he lists here that are obviously not going to last when the fire tests. And these materials are, in verse 12, wood, hay, and straw. Now, if you're familiar with building of buildings, right? Those are all necessary. You need wood to build frames and things of that nature. And back in the old days, they would use hay and straw to make bricks. But listen, what are we building? What are we building here? Why is one going to survive and the other one not? Why is one going to endure and the other one not endure? Because we are building the temple of God. If you look down at verses 16 and 17, it says, "Do you not know that you are the temple of God and that the Spirit of God dwells in you? And if anyone defiles the temple of God, God will destroy him, for the temple of God is holy, which temple you are." We are building the temple of God. It is God's building. We just can't use anything we want. We have to use that which is going to endure, that which, when it's tested, will survive. So some material, and this text is showing us some material is good. Wood, hay, and straw is not necessarily bad, not necessarily evil. It's just not going to endure, nor is the quality, and that's the key word, the quality of the material good enough for the temple of God. Because we're building something that is what? Holy. 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 And so these are all spiritual metaphors for the building of the temple of God, which is the church. And he says this, there is coming a day, look at verse 13, that each one's work, what you do, that's resulting in the gold or the silver or the precious stones, which is probably marble, right? Or the wood and the hay and the straw, those things that you're doing in life are being counted up for you in heaven as either gold or silver or precious stones, or if it's worthless to God, you're just doing it for your own pleasure to some extent. It's just going to be wood, hay, and straw. The fire is going to test the quality of that work. Each one's work will become clear, for the day will declare it. We're all going to appear before the judgment seat of Christ, in which all of our labor in serving God is going to be tested by God to see what value, what quality of work. And the reward that we receive is based on the quality of work. Every believer is going to be judged. And this is not a judgment for sin. This is a judgment for our works. This judgment that we're talking about, that he brings out in this text, is not for unbelievers. If you don't know Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, all the work that you do, believe it or not, these are harsh words. Please take it with love. If you're here this morning and you don't have Christ living in you, if you're not a follower of Christ, all of your work before God is seen as filthy rags. He doesn't accept it. Because your sin separates you from God, and one day God is going to judge you for your sins. Jesus came down from heaven, and all of our sins were placed on him. God punished Jesus in my place and in yours. And so he suffered. And God, so listen, God judged Jesus for all of us. And so if you're here this morning and you put your trust in Jesus to be your Savior, then the judgment seat of Christ is going to be a time of a reward ceremony where all your works are going to be evaluated by Jesus. But it's not a fearful time. It's a happy time. It's going to be a glorious day. All of us are going to be praised by the Lord. But listen, back to that point I made. Some need to understand that this judgment here, judgment seat of Christ, is just for believers. If you're here and you don't have Christ as your Lord and Savior, your judgment is completely different. The moment you die, to be absent, to be bought from the body, you're going to stand before God. If your sins have not been forgiven, if you've never trusted Jesus Christ while you are alive right now, God has to judge you for your sins. But the judgment seat of Christ is not, we're not being judged for our sins. We are being judged for the quality of our work. Every believer will receive praise from the Lord. 1 Corinthians 4, 5. Then each one's praise will come from God. And so as I kind of land this plane here, getting you to think about this judgment, the judgment seat of Christ for believers, what's actually going to be judged? How is God going to judge the believer? Three ways, three areas that Jesus Christ is going to judge the believer. Number one, he's going to judge you for your motives. Number two, he's going to judge you for your conduct, how you are living. And number three, he's going to judge you for your service. All of this is part of the judgment. And again, 2 Corinthians 5, if you want to turn to that, just turn a few pages in your Bible. Mark can get up there fast enough for us. We can get done with my sermon here. 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 9 and 10. And that 1 Corinthians 4, 5 is going to help us understand this. What am I going to be judged for? How do I know if I'm going to receive gold, silver, or precious stone? How do I know if my works are going to be seen as wood, hay, or straw? How do I know? 2 Corinthians 5, 9 and 10. Therefore, we make it our aim. That speaks of motive. Jesus is judging us for our motive. We make it our aim in our life to be, whether present or absent, to be what? Well-pleasing to him. That speaks of aim, that speaks of motive. If you go back to chapter 4, 1 Corinthians, here it says, verse 5, that everything, the judgment will bring to light the hidden things of darkness and reveal the counsels of our heart. And so I am going to be judged for my motives. For my motives. Did I do it for the glory of God? The work that I'm doing, am I doing it for the glory of God or for the praise of man? Am I doing it so that I would get a pat on the back? So people, listen, camera, I'm moving this way. If you go on YouTube, you'll see what I mean, all right? Sometimes they don't know I'm going that way. Listen, our motive, everything we do is going to be judged by God. By the time I got here, I forgot what I was going to say. Let me go back to my notes here for a second. Oh, praise of Ben and praise of God. Okay. Listen, that's crazy, isn't it? We're going to be judged for our motives. Did I do it for the praise of God or did I do it for the praise of men? So in other words, am I looking for people to say, man, I think much of you now. Because you did that, I think much of you. Or am I doing the work that I'm doing because I want people to think much of God? That's the motive. Why do you do what you do as you serve the Lord? Is your motive right? He says that we'll be judged by our conduct. How did I do what I did? Did I do it the right way? Did I take heed how I was building on this foundation? Did I do it my way or did I do it his way? And so my conduct. But my service is also going to be judged because I said God has given all of us a task to do. Are you being obedient to what he's called you to do in your life? Are you doing it with all your heart, soul, and might? So doing it for the glory of God, doing it out of love for Jesus and not love for the praise of man. So if I can answer to those questions in a positive way, that I have the right motive, I have the right conduct, I have the right service. Maybe not all the time, but for most of the time when I'm doing my work for the Lord, and then my reward is going to be what? Gold, silver, and precious stone. But if I've done it for my own benefit, if I've done it for the praise of man, and if I didn't do it the way he wanted me to do it, I did it my way, then my reward is going to be burnt up. It's not going to last. The fire of God's testing, it will be burnt up. And so all of my work can be burnt up and lost. It'll be burnt up in flames. Why? It wasn't worth anything. It wasn't good enough because I'm building the temple of God. And so what is my goal in life? My goal in life is to do my best for who? Do my best for Jesus. I shouldn't settle for less. Paul says in 1 Corinthians 9, I'm in 2 Corinthians. Verse 24, do you not know that those who run in a race all run? Listen, but one receives the prize. Run, live, serve in such a way that you may obtain it. And so he wants us to discipline our bodies and bring it into subjection and to live our lives in a certain way so that we may receive that greater prize, which is gold, silver, and precious stones. And so we need to be serving the Lord in the way that pleases him and building in the way that pleases him and not doing it our own way. We will be rewarded accordingly. And so let each one take heed how he builds. The day is coming where we will be judged for all of our work. If anyone's work is burned, he will suffer loss. And it's not talking about you losing salvation there. That's talking about losing the work, losing the reward. If you have done all this building and you've built it your way and not built it his way, no reward. You might have done it. Sometimes you've done it the right way, and sometimes you did it the wrong way. And so there'll be some praise, and you'll lose some reward. I just want to end here in verses 16 and 17. It says, do you not know that you are the temple of God and that the Spirit of God dwells in you? If anyone defiles the temple of God, God will destroy him, for the temple of God is holy, which temple you are. This is a third category of people. The first category are those who are being rewarded with gold and silver. And the second category are those who are not receiving rewards because it's wood, hay, and straw. These are not builders. These are destroyers. These are people like these false teachers. Yesterday we were out putting tracts on people's doors, and as we were out there doing that, we saw some other religious people out knocking on people's doors, and they're Jehovah's Witnesses, and they're not building on the right foundation. They have their own foundation. Because they're not building on the teachings of Christ. They're building on the teachings of the religious leader who started that ministry. It's a false teaching. And so this is implying right here, do you not know that you are the temple of God and that the Spirit of God dwells in you? And so how we build the temple of God, the motivation, I am building something, not a physical structure here. I'm building my life. I'm building the church on the foundation, and I must build it in a way that pleases God because God himself, the Holy Spirit, is going to fill the temple with his presence. It's not talking about this building here. This is not a holy place. It's talking about you. It's talking about me. We are the temple of God. When we are gathered together, we are the church. And listen, when people try to destroy the church, Christianity, the warning here is they will be destroyed. Now, this is not talking about persecution and Christians being killed. That's happened. That's a contradiction if you're thinking that way. Scripture and both reason teach us that God allows persecution. He allows even Christians to die for their faith. But God will not allow the church to be ultimately destroyed because it's built on the foundation of Jesus Christ, and nothing can destroy that. And so our lives are built on that sure foundation, and nothing can destroy the teaching, the person of Christ, and this foundation. And God wants us to take this warning seriously. Each believer must take this warning seriously because God cares the way we live. He cares about how we build the church. So he says, let each one take heed how he builds. It doesn't matter, therefore, how successful you are, how popular you are, or how much you are commended by people, because there's coming a day when each believer's work will be tested by fire, and the fire will reveal your work, the quality of your work. Even our secret thoughts and the motivations of our hearts are going to be revealed by the Lord. So the Lord, he loves us, and he's giving a motivation for us. Not for us to walk in fear, but a motivation to be rewarded, to one day hear from the mouth of Jesus, well done, thou good and faithful servant. You've done well. And I don't know about you, but I know why I serve. I know why I do what I do. Because I want Jesus to know that I love him. And I want to hear from his mouth, Gordon, you did good. Well done, thou good and faithful servant. And so every believer is a servant. It is a privilege to serve. Each one is given a task. No task is greater than the other. Each of us will be rewarded. Each of our work will be tested. And so, Christian, are you serving Jesus today? Are you truly serving Jesus? And if you are you doing your best? Because it matters, does it not? It matters how we build. It matters to Jesus. And so my plea with you this morning is, would you make a commitment today to serve if you're not serving? And then would you also make a commitment if you are serving? Would you examine, evaluate for yourself before this day comes how you are serving? Because it matters to Jesus. And so I pray that you would make that commitment. And if you don't know what your spiritual gift is, and you don't know what you should be doing, you need to come and talk to us, because we're here to help you with that. Let's pray. I ask that the music people come forward now and prepare for our closing song. And as every head is bowed and every eye is closed, and just thinking about the word that we heard this morning, what will be your response? The day is coming. You can postpone and change things on schedules, but you can't stop this day. It's coming. And so as you are thinking through what God's word said to you this morning, perhaps you're here this morning and, boy, you're saying to yourself, I'm not building my life on that foundation. I've never received Christ as my Lord and Savior. May today you just simply call out to Jesus and say, Jesus, I've been trusting myself. I've been trusting my church. I've been thinking that I was good enough. You died for my sins. You were buried and you rose again. And I realize today that I can't save myself. You died to save me, and I trust you as my Savior. But your head is bowed and your eyes closed. If you're trusting Jesus to be your Savior, and this is the first time you just called out to him just now to save you, could you raise your hand so every head is bowed and every eye is closed, no one else is looking. Just raise your hands. I'm going to pray for you in the end of our service today just to thank the Lord for you. Anybody at all not sure that Jesus is your Savior? I want to pray also for every Christian here this morning. How are you building? How are you serving? If you need to make a commitment today, take that step of faith and say, I need to serve. Would you make that commitment in a prayer to the Lord today and say, Lord, here I am. My life belongs to you. I'm here to serve you. Now, I'm not going to have anybody raise their hand for that. But in your heart, if that's your desire, you got to make sure you come and speak to us. Maybe you already are serving, but maybe you need to serve the quality of your service that you want to do your best. You're doing it. You're not doing your best. May today be a day that you commit to do your best, to run in such a way you receive that prize. Father, I pray that you will transform Calvary Baptist Church the way you want to build it, your building, as we submit to you. And I pray that everybody here that calls this their home church will commit to build Calvary Baptist in our life the way you want us to build it. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Amen. Well, if I could be of any help to you spiritually, make sure you come and talk to us. We're going to stand and sing an invitational song. And during this time of singing, you can all stand if you want. You're sitting for about 30 minutes or so, 35 minutes. I'm not sure how long that was. Oldie but a goodie. Sang that song in a while. It was a good song. Amen. Let's pray. Father, thank you so much for blessing us with this day to worship you, to praise you, and to be challenged. And Lord, may your word just work its way through our lives and our hearts and reveal to us things that need change, things that need to be even praised. Many times, Lord, we need to be thanked, and we're praised for the things we've done. We're serving you, and you are smiling upon us as we serve you. And so I pray for encouragement, and I pray for correction. I pray you will have your way in our hearts, that we will continually grow in the grace and knowledge of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. And he's the reason why we are gathered this morning, because of all that he's done. Jesus, we love you and we praise you. Have your way in our hearts. In Jesus' name, amen. Hey, have a seat. We're going to have the ushers come forward and take our morning offering. If you're visiting with us this morning,
you're gonna have to go over.
Please don't feel obligated to give. There's a little tear-off card on that bulletin that you received when you came in. Please tear that off and fill it out. Put it in the offering plate when it comes by. For all those who are God's people here this morning, this is your church. We thank you for your gifts. And I'm going to have a word of prayer and pray that the Lord would bless our giving and that we would use it to glorify him. So let's all bow and thank the Lord for this time of offering. Father, as we continue worshiping you, we're still worshiping you in the way that we give, and even in the amount that we give. We want to be a cheerful giver. We want to give abundantly as you have blessed us and trust you. And so I pray that we would all be cheerful givers, and we would give as though we were giving it directly to you. Mm-hmm. May you be blessed and glorified in our act of worship, in the giving of the wonderful resources that you've given to us. Thank you, Father, in Jesus' name, amen.
What a wonderful name it is, the name.
young lady that's going to come out of these curtains here. Here she is. Come on up here, Ms. Serena. Let me grab that way. Nice and warm. All right, watch that step. Look at that. Smart. All right. Never liked water in microphones. You see those YouTube videos too? Okay, it's low voltage. Oh, look at that. See, my daughter's watching out for me. So this would still get electrocuted probably, but it'd be lower voltage. Well, we have here the beautiful Serena Donadio, and she has a testimony. She's trusted Jesus Christ as a Lord and Savior, and I met with her to ask her why she wanted to go in this water tank here and be baptized, and she had some really good answers to the questions I was asking her, so I felt that she's ready to be baptized. But I figure, since you know most of the people here, you can give a little testimony of why do you want to get baptized today?
I want to take the next step in my faith just to show how much I love God. He's always had my back and been there for me.
Right. Amen. Amen. Did Jesus do something special for you?
He kind of just hit me one day. I was just like ready to do it. So
what is the most important thing that Jesus did for not just you but for everybody?
Died on the cross.
Well, what did he die for?
Our sins.
Yeah, amen, amen. Can you grab that mic? All right, Serena, as your pastor, I take great delight, and I'm praising the Lord for the wonderful privilege of baptizing you, my sister, in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. And so I want you to take that hand and cover that nose, if you want to grab and have a little seat. Buried in the likeness of his death, raised to newness of life. Amen. Amen. Praise the Lord. Praise God. All right. Anybody over here? They must have trusted you. They think that you're okay. No one here to help you out here, huh? All right. Okay. Okay? All right. Do announcements.
I just want to encourage you, okay, to invite someone out to church, because people will come out on Easter, and so many of our friends and family have never really heard the gospel. They really haven't, okay? So they'll come, and the preacher will preach, and they'll hear the gospel, and this is a great thing. And that's the least we can do. Just invite someone, give them a gospel tract. If you don't have any Easter tracts, let me know. We've got Easter tracts. You can give them out and invite people. But that's it.
You have one more song you want to do?
I'd like to do another song. I'm just going to do a solo, if that's okay.
You guys want to hear him do a solo? Yeah.
Michaela doesn't. Come on up here, Michaela.
Solo that no one else hears it.
Stand. We're going to you might clap your hands a couple of times,
darkness, whose love is mighty and so much stronger, the King of glory, the King above all kings.